Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today we continue with the series of videos I'm doing about LLMOps with MLflow, and today we will see how to approach the LLM evaluation with this library, with MLflow. As usual, I have prepared a notebook, and later on I will upload to the repository, and you will be able to download to your local environment and run it yourself and extend it as your convenience. MLflow had implemented, well, better said, had extended the current evaluated class that the default evaluator class that they had to work with the libraries that they integrate natively with the library MLflow. You probably know that there is a long list of these libraries which integrate. Let me take a show you some of them. It's probably better to open a new. So there is a number of the libraries on the area of deep learning, traditional ML, etc., like scikit-learn, XGBoost, etc., Apache Spark, StatModel, etc. Also, we had libraries in the deep learning area, like PyTorch, TensorFlow, others. Well-known libraries, obviously, SpaceIF, SAPI. Sorry, an interaction. Well, as I said, integrated with libraries, TensorFlow, PyTorch, Keras, SpaceIF from deep learning, and also with LLMs, either commercial, non-commercial, and also with tools like LangChain, LlamaIndex, and others. So, MLflow today is probably one of the most used libraries in terms of the leveraging the machine learning lifecycle. You can use it for tracking. You can use it for evaluating models to in hyperparameter tuning, in inference, in any kind of processes involved in for model governance as well. So every process that is involved on machine learning in the machine learning lifecycle, you can leverage it with the use of MLflow. One of the things that was missing, it was on experimental. We spoke about this months ago. Still was in experimental phase. How they will leverage as well the process of working with LLMs, which obviously is a little bit more complex than other technologies into the world of the artificial intelligence. There is much more variety at the same time, and also somehow it's a little bit more abstract how to evaluate this kind of model. So the tool what they have implemented is a solution, extending what they already have and adapting this to to the specific case of how to evaluate LLM. We will cover this in some minutes. Apart of that, they are working intensively on the area of LLMs because obviously in terms of the deep learning and conventional machine learning, they are already quite covered. They had a tool, a mature tool, and well, many people is using. The only thing that they are just is progressing on the roadmap for that technologies. So there is not many things to do. You want to say that on terms of what they are doing on that area. So they are focusing, as everybody, practically the whole industry is now focusing on the use of LLMs, and that's exactly the case of what MLflow is doing. You probably remember we mentioned it in the channel as well. MLflow now is maintained by Databricks, so it's a very professional team behind as well, at the beginning as well, they were very professional. I don't want to say that they were not professional before. They are, so, but I, what I want to see that they have a very big company, a very big corporation with a tool which is broadly used on the industry for data engineering and data analytics and data science, no? With this Databricks. In terms of LLMs, they only not they also finished the other features that they had in evaluation, which is tracing the how the LLM is performing prompting, how to do prompt engineering on with the MLflow and evaluate it, tracking as well, very important as we. Already commented, it's very important to keep track of what everything that we are doing in our experiments, and that's where MLflow come to help. Now it's able to keep track of what you are doing during your prompt engineering, when you are evaluating the answers of different models, and also keeping trace of what's going on, similar to what, for example, LangChain had with LangSmith. Something very similar, everything integrated on the same UI, and we will cover now this on the notebook. We are going to cover the evaluation only for LLMs today. In the next video, I don't know when I will do it, but soon we will cover as well how to evaluate RAG components, RAG agents. So, as I mentioned before, this is an extension of the current evaluator class, which is there for a long time, and they just extended the class with new functionalities. I will provide later all the information to you be able to read and analyze what we have. No? The tool is already, I will say, in production. It's not experimental anymore. So only some small areas where they are still working. Don't cover all the tags that are possible to do when we work with LLMs. So I mean that in the roadmap of MLflow, as I saw in some of the notes and release notes, they are going to keep introducing more features on this area. And well, for the time being, they are offering, as I said, this what you see in the screen. We will cover this in a couple of seconds. There is two ways to evaluate the LLMs. One is the default of the basics, which are included for any evaluation of your LLM. Basically, here what we want to do here is to get from using a systematic approach to analyze what an LLM is answering us when we formulate some questions. And then we want to cover different metrics or approach this evaluation in a systematic way, and and it's here where MLflow code to help. And then there is some default metrics that they use that which depends on the type of activity that we are evaluating, question answering, text summarization, text generation, and retrievers as well. So when we use a vector store, and this is part of the stuff that we will review on the next video when we talk about RAG. So usually a RAG component used to have behind or to help or is being used to help a retriever, a component which just simply keep information in of private data on the form of embeddings vectors. So for the we had essentially different metrics which give us a score. Some of them between 0 to 1, some others are specific metrics which probably you never hear about, if you are not a specialist or how to say, you are working on this topic to the very low level, no? It's very difficult to you hear some of the metrics that they are using. Some others, yes, it's not a very well-known routes for text summarization. Toxicity, you probably get an idea. It's used everywhere. It's just giving us an idea. They are using a model. They are implementing the or using the evaluate metric from evaluate library from transformers from Hugging Face Hub, and they use under the hood unless that you define something different the Roberta Hate Speech model. So this is a metric which give us a score 1 to 0 to we understand how toxic is the answer, if it contains any great of toxicity or offensive language included on the answer. No, this is you probably know that today, especially in some countries, this is a topic which is broadly discussed, and then it had to be constantly measure, especially on those environments where there is human interaction, for example, social networks or conference rooms, these kind of things where there is different people with different background interacting together. So toxicity at the same time is evaluated, because at the end of the day most of the LLMs are trained with dataset which may contain this dataset usually are very big, and then on it's impossible to review all the words that are included on our datasets, or very very complicated and costly, and probably in some of the texts that we are using for training they are including some offensive speech. So there is other, for example, in question and answer, that this will be the example that we will use today. There is a chat match, which is you have a what they say run through. We will see an example here. The way that we do it is just we create an input, a prompt, and we have a run through that is the answer that that we use, that we consider as valid. So the exact match is meaning is a score which tell us how close to the run through is our is the answer of the model. Of course, this is there is a great a very big grade of subjectivity here, because the ground through the answer, the correct answer, unless that is a mathematical problem where there is no way to there is no other interpretation of the answer, but in other scenarios, well, the ground through, in my opinion, no, this is again this is something very subjective. It's very difficult to set. No, we have to set one, and then we want to evaluate this versus a run through, and then on the score that we get in a SAT match is how close is our the answer of the model versus the run through. This even when we are talking about very specific topics like medicine or law or some others, is even probably more complicated. But well, this is another topic. We are going to see here how we can implement an evaluation framework with the help of the MLflow. So there is a toxicity, Chasmar roads, probably you know this is a very well-known metric for summarization. All these metrics, as I said, is applied and we got a score. No? We had ARI grade level, I give you ARI grade level, is how easy or how is a way to evaluate how the readability of the test. No, they provide a score which tells you how what this will be the age or the in this case is the grade level. This is something that has been set up for the US school, and then to in which grade level fall the readability of the test. No, let's say that you get a score of 3, this means that it's easily read by a person who is on the second grade with the age of 7-8 years. So this is a measure just to understand how clear and concise are the answers of our LLM. Similarly, the Fletch Kincaid grade level is something very similar, which also measure the test in terms of the readability and also give us an score which makes sense or make some impact if the score is greater than 10. So again, there are some metrics. These are the default ones that they use together with the count of number of tokens, and is a way to evaluate, is a starting point. You also can create your custom metrics and include it on the metrics that MLflow will use to evaluate the answers of your model. So we need a run through. We created either based on examples, as you saw on the notebook, or we can use as well dataset available in Hugging Face Hub, which are ready to evaluate or are designed to fine tune and to evaluate models for a specific task. We can cover this in a specific video as well, how to use these datasets. It's not included on the next one I will prepare about RAG. So this is one of the default metrics it uses, and the second one is use an LLM to use the answer of the LLM that we want to evaluate. This is include probably even more subjective, because here we are using a model like GPT-4 or Gemini or Anthropic models, or even models that are available in Hugging Face Hub. We use a model, usually the model probably bigger than the one that we want to evaluate, and we use it to evaluate. Here, essentially, what we define is there is some templates with some predefined metrics to use. We're using a second LLM, a master or a judge. Is using these templates, predefined templates in MLflow, evaluate the content or the answer of the model versus a metric that we define in this is defined in this template or you can define as well a custom one. We will cover this as well on the second part. You can take here metrics with an LLM as the judge, and then you had similarity, correctness, relevance, how the model generate output that is to the, o sea, relevant to the input, and the other relevance, how the output is relevant versus the input and the context provided. No? And five full net is the, these are templates also already defined in MLflow, which are also mapped to the different tags that we are able to evaluate, and then you can use one or combination of them, or even define, as we will see here in two examples, you will be able to create your own metrics based on how is the method that is predefined to create custom metrics. So we had methods to create a Gen AI metric, and the way to do it is simply we define, you create a definition, you create a scoring or a grading prompt, a rule set, how you should score the output based on the rules that you, for example, predefine here, and you provide an example. So here is just creating via prompt engineering with some few shot sampling as well, how to tell a second model to evaluate the answer of the model that we want to evaluate. We will be covering both in the notebook, and I hope that is clear after this. And again, we will continue with this. It's a really interesting topic. As I mentioned before, it's really subjective the way that how we can evaluate an LLM has to be done. In some cases, apart from being subjective, is you may need an expert on the matter that from what you are creating the agent or the RAG component, because obviously we may not have enough knowledge to understand either the values or, and especially to create these prompts and create the scoring mechanism to evaluate the answers of the model. Let me give you an example. Let's imagine that we are creating a model to support the diagnosis, or I don't know, to provide an answer for a legal topic. It's not necessary to replace, obviously, probably never gonna replace a lawyer or a doctor, but if the model is providing you, I don't know, an advice in some matter, it's clear that at least me, I'm not prepared, no, to understand if the answer of the model is correctly done or not, and how to score these answers. So, as I mentioned at the beginning, it's quite subjective, and in some cases we may need subject matter experts on the topic that we want to create this tool in order to prepare this evaluation metrics and process. Okay, let's start. We will be seeing discussing this as well during the execution of the model. I'm working on Colab Pro. I installed the libraries I need. I here installing the version 2.12. We had already the 12.17, it ain't no grown. Yeah, you can install the latest, there is no problem at all. So far, the only need to consider is to install evaluate from transformers and TextStat. TextStat is a library, it's already there for a long time as well. And well, it's a library that provides some metrics around readability, complexity, and grade level. This is how they are building these metrics. And as you can see here, TextStat provides some others, which essentially we can implement as custom metrics and include it on our evaluation process. We install the libraries, we install as well, we run MLflow in the Collab Pro using the, here we are just simply getting the IPython shell and running the server in the background on the port 5000. And here we use NGROK infrastructure to redirect the port from our Collab notebook to the NGROK infrastructure. This way we are tunneling everything that is in and out to the port 5000 on the box where is running the Collab Pro. That's how we can get here the UI of the MLflow running on the box. So here we just import, we are going to use OpenAI for both, for the model that we are going to evaluate and for the model that we will use as a judge. The model that we are going to use for evaluation is MiniGPT-4o, and the model that we will use for two judges in the second part of the notebook, it will be GPT-4. So basic question answering evaluation. Here you have all the links to get the understanding of the different metrics, toxicity, TextStat, etc. To which metrics apply to which or how the metrics are mapped to the different tags. And here the way to do it, either as you can see here, we define a data frame with two columns, inputs and ground truth. In any case, later we can so the input is clear, the input is the prompt. And the targets you can name whatever you please, so far that you keep what you state on the data frame, state the same in, or you put here, you can name these targets as well, but here you will see you have to say, or you have to write targets on the evaluate model. So we can use a data frame that we prepare ourselves, or we can use one of the multiple data sets that we had available on Hugging Face had for fine-tuning models. My plan, as I mentioned before, is I want to do something with the summarization. That is one of the activities I've been working on. And I had some videos as well already on the channel, how we can fine-tune models for summarization. If you remember, we use at that time T5, Mistral as well. We can retake this work that we did months ago and use now this evaluation process or evaluation framework to systematically evaluate the outputs of the fine-tuning. It will be a nice exercise, especially now when we can do the fine-tuning and then on the evaluation using this metric on the same platform on MLflow. So we can repeat some of these processes and then on use the everything that you are going to see here with a specific tag and see from a process end to end how to do the fine tuning, repeat the fine tuning as we saw months ago with one of the models, the T5 or Mistral or one of the new ones that we had, like Microsoft Phi or whatever, any model, and then on apply this framework and verify how we can do this or how we can apply these metrics and how we can understand how the model is answering or doing the task that for what we fine tune the model. So for this exercise today, we will create a data frame with the inputs and the ground truth. Again, this in my opinion is quite subjective. We set up the experiment. Let's create it again. And now we are gonna first of all lock the model. You probably remember that we can lock the models in we can lock the model in MLflow later on download it and use it. Here any model that implement the OpenAI API can be locked in MLflow, and then on simply we will see now how it looks like. It's just a reference, and here the only thing that we are doing is just keeping in the tracking server the definition of the connection that we do to the API, in this case of the OpenAI. So we save this, and then on we are going to use the model here to evaluate. We will review now this on the MLflow. Essentially here, first of all, in this part of the run, we lock the model into MLflow, and then on here we evaluate. We take the URI of the model, we take it from the run. We use our eval df data frame, this one that we create here. We tell the model that what is our target, the title tags, and the evaluators here, the default. Defaults here, everything that we saw here, no? These are the defaults from question asterisk. Satmax, toxicity, airy, grade level, and flinch, Kincaid, grade level. So as you see here, for the toxicity, we download the model. You can see here the downloading the model. We download as well the metrics from evaluate library, etc. So everything the first time happens automatically, and once everything is ready, MLflow just apply what he had to do, apply the so get the answers from the model and apply the metrics to the answers in comparison with what we define as ground truth. This is creating a pandas data frame, and you can see here our input, the ground truth, the output of the model, the token count, the toxicity score, the flash Kincaid grade level. Remember that this had to be relevant about 10, so as bigger is more the most relevant, more easy to read, you want to say that. And the other score you can check, for example, 20 in the ARI, it means that score is higher for a user that is above 22, so you need a person with high studies to understand this test. Something that well here 14.5. Let me check this. Yeah, here college student. So here you have the definition, but this is for UK, the grade levels. Okay, so this is the basic. Now let's take a look what's going on here in MLflow. So you had here the experiment. So we had our experiment. You can see it's exactly the same that anything that we do in MLflow. Our metrics are locked. We had the metrics as well in the section metrics. Here is the login of the model, as any other model. We are saving, in this case, is the access to a nested cage. Here just we had the definition of the model, the Python we use, the MLflow version, which flavor we are using, MLflow OpenAPI version, etc. We have here how to replicate this with a Conda environment, a Python environment, which come together with a requirements TST. And here how the outputs of the, this is also locked in the experiment. As I mentioned at the beginning, in order to get traceability of what how we are building our model, how we are testing, evaluating all the process to create anything in AI, it's not already a good practice. It's something that is already a requirement today. It's thought to be a best practice long ago. Today, if we want to implement a model, you need to explain the user how you get to the conclusion that the model is correctly trained according to the requirement, how our predictions or forecasts are contains no bias in terms of different metrics. And in this case, we had an approach, probably we can argue if the approach is, how to say, completely correct or not, according to, in my opinion, as I mentioned from the beginning, there is a lot of subjectivity here, but in any case, we have a starting point. No? And then this is something that probably we need to review, to discuss internally on the teams how this can be explained, if this is really translating that the model is correctly working according to what the user, the final user expects, and so on and so forth. But as I said, this in comparison with 1 year ago or 2 years ago, well, that was nothing. And then on, at least, even with some great subjectivity here, this is a starting point. Okay, now let's take a look how to do this with using us a LLM dupes. In this case, we are going to use GPT-4 to evaluate the answers of the GPT-4o mini. So here you have the documentation. We had some templates defined. You take a look with the help or with going to the pages I point you here. I give you here there all the complete documentation. The help is something like this. It's explaining you how to implement this. All the templates that provide for the time being MLflow works exactly the same, and also the method where I have it, evaluation similarity. The method make gen AI metric is exactly the same. So you need to, in the template, you had some of the job done by the MLflow team, and in the, if you make one yourself, defining a metric, the only thing that you need to prepare, as you will see here, is something similar to this, no? In the case that this is a template, you just need to provide examples. As you can understand here, what we are doing is provide some. We are doing few shot sampling, prompting. Sorry, few shot prompting in this to evaluate the answer of the model, and then you can provide two or three examples. The samples are creating Always, as you see here on the screen, you need an input, an output, the score, the justification, and how to grade, how is grading the context. No, you can apply, this is optional in any case, the grading context. This is some context that you can provide on the example. You can provide as much as you want. We discussed this already long ago, that more than 6 samples is already demonstrated that is having no impact on the model. You are only spending tokens. The usually 2-3 is the general rule to apply to 2-3 examples, 4 maximum, 5 or 6. I didn't see many examples or in no libraries or not practitioners using 5 or 6. When even as I said before, there is some research already which tell us what is the inflection point where using more examples it makes no impact on the quality of the answer of the model. So here we create for this, we are going to use in this case answer similarity, which is one of the templates that we have already created by the MLflow team. And then on, we provide an example. Again, this input and output is, in my opinion, the input is clear, the output is what is subjective, also the score, and then on, is not an easy process to do, and especially is even more complicated when there is a topic where you had no expertise on. And then once you have the example, you create an object or answer similarity, you apply the model. It can be any model that in mode SAS implement the OpenAI SDK. For example, you can use Olama, you can use Olama framework to serve a transformers model, and you will be able to use it as a tubes. You can use as well NVIDIA NIM, use the SDK which is working, which implement as well the OpenAI SDK framework or OpenAI API framework. You pass the examples, and you can see here essentially what we are going to pass to the LLM for evaluation. We pass an input, the output of the model that we want to evaluate, the grading context columns, and a number. You can see here that the mechanism to score is already defined in the template, and then on you don't need to create it. Here we are going to create another answer quality definition. We want to evaluate the quality of the answer of the model, and here there is a definition of what is quality, how we can evaluate it. Here is the definition of the metric, here is the scoring rules, and here we provide 2 examples. We create a metric, pretty similar, and here finally we had we create a prompt at the end. No? So let me check if I already run this because I don't remember. Tag, and now we create this answer quality definition. So here the same. The name is going to be answer quality. The definition is answer quality definition. We have created here is just text. The grading prompt. Here is the scoring rules, the version, this is the version of the API, examples, the model to evaluate, and we tell greater is better. So if you get This is something similar to what we use when we optimize a model. We just tell what is the direction where the optimization algorithm had to go. If you had to go down to reduce loss, it's positive. If you want to maximize, for example, R2 or accuracy, you just to have to say convert or pass a negative to the value. So you have to just tell what is better in order to the model provide a correct answer. But similarly to the template, what you are creating is simply a prompt to pass to the model. Now we do the same, and we pass, we create a, in a run, and we evaluate a random type evaluate. We use the same model, the mini, the GPT-4o mini, our evaluation dataset, same run through. Model type, question answering, we didn't change the tags. Evaluator, we are going to produce the default again, and we use these two metrics, extra metrics that we already defined, the similarity and the quality. Now we are processing and evaluating, and at the same time everything is locked into MLflow. Okay, it's done. Now we can just plot the data frame, and you can see here the same toxicity, token counts, flash kinkade, array level, similarity here. You have the similarity score and the quality score. Okay, so now we are going to do another example, professionalism. All these examples I took them from the documentation, so I'm not inventing anything. Does give you, or at least to me, give me, or for the time being, I think is something that, and again, especially if the tax or if the model pretend to help in some activity where is you may need a specialist to create this. The grading prompt and the definition, how to do this, as to somebody get enough experience to do this, because it, in my opinion, is very subjective. No, here we create professionalism. It's a strictly casual, the language that is using casual but generally respectful, blah blah blah. Well, you can take a look. It's exactly the same that we do before for quality. Here is another metric that we define ourselves, and we are just creating another prompt, and we pass the same data frame to the model. So we can include this on the other together with the other, and then we will get all of them at the same time. We evaluate the table. And as you can see here, professionalism, we get 3, 4, 4. So here, if you look at the original prompt that we used to with GPT-4i for O mini, it's just simply answer the following question in two sentences. Now we can check if improving in if doing some improvements in our prompt, we get, for example, an improvement in the professionalism metric. No, in this case, we are going to run the model versus or using another prompt. You can extend this as much as you want, even including giving some examples. He's obviously free. You try to improve how the model is could answer to your questions. Here we are just telling the model, it's zero soft prompting here, that you should use an extremely formal language. So we run our model, and then on there is an evaluation, and we will see if changing the prompt we are getting a better professionalism. We prompt the table, and well, here, yeah, there is a 344. Here we are getting 445. No? So you can see here the effect of changing prompts. We can even include, as I mentioned before, some examples. Here is prompt engineering, in few words, what we are using here, and using another model to evaluate the output of the first one. Here, if you go to the UI, we had again all the experiments, and now you can use here in evaluation. You can you can use all the experiments and also group by inputs, compare the run through, compare the token counts, compare different metrics. Depending on the how to say, this is essentially a dashboard to you be able to group the different experiments that you have done. Imagine that like we do now at the end, we do two let's do it here. We are just doing to compare. We had two experiments where we are evaluating the professionalism, and then on you can change the prompt in different ways, and you can evaluate here how every experiment is performing, no? So differently, similarly, like we did before when we work with a machine learning model or a deep learning model, we use the same UI, the same approach to visualize how different, for example, when we did the hyperparameter tuning with the MLflow, we use the same visualizations, and we use the same logic to compare the different. You can see here this grade, the same plots, and the contour plot. We use the same visualization tools to evaluate how the different parameters in our hyperparameter tuning process were doing an influence on the metrics. And then here is exactly the same. We define the metrics, and then we can compare them here. They specify a different section here, because obviously this is specifically done for LLMs, and in many cases there is many things that are quite different from what we use in evaluating deep learning or machine learning models. And well, that's pretty much all. You can see that there is really a lot of going on this area. The same that everything around today in generative AI, in when we talk about LLMs, everything that is in this area is progressing very fast, and in any aspect that we need for working with the LLMs is progressing. One of the hot topics today is evaluation, because as I said, you may create a very sophisticated agent, but if you don't convince the user that the answers that the agent is providing are not good enough, and you don't use a systematic approach to do this, you probably will not convince anybody that to use the tool, no? And this it doesn't matter if you are an external consultant or an internal employee of a company. We need to, and the same that we did with deep learning models or with machine learning models, we need to find a way to explain the explainability, this concept that is today as well is a hot topic as well. We need to explain clearly without any doubt and convince the users how our models behave, and they systematically can answer correctly or with a great of correctness, and we have to be able to demonstrate and to show this. And the only way to do it is this. Again, in my opinion, there is some subjectivity here, but at least it's a systematic approach that is you have a complete traceability in a tool that you can later on use to provide in a submission to a governmental organization how you did all the fine-tuning, preparation, exploratory data analysis, evaluation, hyperparameter tuning, everything that you need to do during the creation of your AI components can be done in MLflow. And this is one of the latest features incorporated to help to build or to work with LLMs. Okay, that's pretty much all. Really, in my opinion as well, very interesting topic. Hot topic today, how to evaluate models, LLMs. And we will continue discussing this. I will prepare a couple of notebooks because I also very interested on this, on to find, as I'm working these days intensively on the area of the RAC, creating RAC components, I'm also very interested in exploring and having a tool which helped me to create and especially to evaluate, because creating, we have a lot of tools today already. We have frameworks like LangChain, Semantic Kernel, Llama Index. We had vector stores. We had models that are commercial, non-commercial, all of them fantastic. Multimodal models, non-multimodal models. So we have a lot of stuff there, but at the end, again, we need a tool to help, which is necessary to help us to sell what we are doing to the user, to the client, to whoever, and explain. And to keep the traceability of what we are doing to create these models. Okay, that's pretty much all. I will upload now the notebook to the repository, and I will put a pointer into a reference in the description of the video. And I hope that you find this interesting and useful, as usual, for your job, for your training, for whatever reason are you watching these videos. And if so, just give me a like, subscribe to the channel if you didn't subscribe before, make comments and all this stuff share with your friend and colleagues to help me to grow in YouTube. Thank you very much, and keep tuned on the channel. I'm almost posting every day videos on YouTube about these topics, and then keep tuned, and then thank you very much and see you soon.